what is object-oriented programming? Object-oriented programming, is it some kind of new technology? Is it just another programming language? Or what is it? So, object-oriented programming, to be simply said, is a way of thinking. It's an approach to do software development. Nothing more than that. So, is that the only approach for programming? Is that the only available way of thinking in programming? Certainly not. So, when we talk about programming really started with the invention of computers. Right from the moment computers were invented, programming was there. Because programming in its very basic is nothing but giving instructions to the computer. And without instructions, no computer will ever work. So there was programming always. At the beginning of the computing era, the programming was usually limited to machine language programming. Right? Machine language programming means set of instructions that are aimed at particular machine, particular processor, to be honest. Right? Usually, you will find machine language codes, like example to be taken like this. They are nothing but sequence of bits, right? And imagine if you are now developing an Android application and I ask you to write a code in machine language. That means you have to write sequence of bits. Will that really be possible? No. So that's what everyone thought, and people moved on to next way of programming, and that was known as assembly language programming. Assembly language programming was a bit better than machine language programming in a sense that assembly language was more like English. This is nothing like English. It's just a combination of 1 and 0. You can't say what is this. This might be, you know, what? I mean, this might be like I am not gay, or maybe I fucking don't know what it is. So it's hard to make sense of this thing, right? But assembly language, if I were to give you an example, it was something like this. Add A to B, move B to C, jump 9000. So this sentence basically means that add value of A to B, then copy the value of B to C, jump to instruction number 9000, something like that. So this is much better than the assembly programming, right? Still, this was not sufficient. Again, I ask you the same question. Create an Android app for maybe, let's say, managing the billing system in a Walmart. Can you write the code using this kind of programming instructions? You can't, right? So, again, they came up with new thing, that is structured programming. One instance of this is procedural programming. And the most popular example of this would be C. All those languages around 1970s, late 1970s or late 60s were structured in nature. What do you understand by structured in nature? They had these programming constructs that you and I use. If else, loops, functions. So they were more structured. This is not structured. If you want to implement looping in assembly language, it's like jump there, then go back, something like that. Whereas in procedural language, you have proper structured programming constructs like, you know, decision making constructs, looping constructs, functions, right? So this made programming much, much better in any regard. And this was the most popular programming till, you could say, mid 90s. So what went wrong? What's the problem in structure? Now I think my C programs are fantastically readable. They can achieve most of the things and people have told me that C is used in operating system implementation. So what's wrong with this? So the thing is, approach in C was to divide the big logic into set of functions, right? So overall the emphasis was on functionality, not on data, right? That's one thing. Second thing is, I agree that in C, by creating lots of functions, program becomes more manageable. But that has a certain limit. If your program goes beyond, let's say, certain limit, for example, 30,000 lines of code is crossed, then even if you break down that, let's say, 30,000 lines of code into 5 functions, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, let's say 4 functions, then each of these functions will also be about 8,000 8,000 lines of code, right? And then again, even these functions are unmanageable. You can't hope to possibly debug 8,000 lines of code all at once. Further, more complicated thing is, as I said earlier, the emphasis in structured programming, or you could say procedural approach, was on functions, not on data. And if you ask any IT client of your company, what's the one thing about which customer really cares? It's not your functionality, it's about data. Big corporations and big companies, they all pay just to secure the data or to extract some meaningful information from the data. You can't make data public, or you can't possibly let data play loose. So when you divide the C program into five functions, first approach to share data amongst functions is to make a data global. When you make some data global, all the functions can use it, right? The problem is, now there's some data which is common to these three functions, right? You can declare it as global, or you could pass that data as an argument to three functions. When you pass the same data as an argument to three functions, it's wastage of memory, right? You are passing the same data to three functions. So in order to avoid that, we can declare it as global. The problem with global is that now there's one more function which has no business with this data, but still it has a free right to access that data, because global can be accessed by any and every function. So this function might accidentally access this because of the same name or naming conflict or something like that, and might actually change the value, and this change value will be affecting the functionality of other three functions. So data is not safe, because nobody thought about data that much. They were all about function, function, function. Getting it? So emphasis was on functionality, not on data. People thought, we need something else, we need something new. And then there's this third reason, which is, I think, is the most important reason of all, is that there was a gap between developers and clients. When I say clients, it's someone who gives you the project to your company, and then you are the developer who develops that project for that particular client. So let's take this example. We have this sports complex in the neighborhood. They have this fantastic tennis courts over there, which I use a lot. One problem that I found was, the tennis courts had to be booked manually by going to their office. And that office was open only till 6 p.m. in the evening. Sometimes, because of my job timings, I had to play late at night, let's say from 10 to 11. So in that case, I would have to make two trips to the office. First to book the tickets, book the courts, and then again at the night to actually play. So I went to the complex and I met the owner, and I said to him, why don't you develop an online booking system for your tennis courts? That will be really handy. We don't have to make any trip to your office. Anyone could book the courts from anywhere in the world. My brother could book it for me, right? So then he said, he was like interested a bit. So we started talking about how to develop that. So I was a technical person who was talking about frameworks, and we shall use this language, we shall use that language, maybe we could use, this function, something like that. And that guy is totally non-technical. He doesn't understand bit of computers, nothing at all, right? More or less. So he was talking like, we have 1200 active users, we have 15 security men, we have 4 tennis courts, we have 5 lights, we provide tennis balls at this rate, we have cold booking timings, we have this, we have that, we do this, we do that. Are you getting it? What I'm trying to say here. I was more concerned about, okay, shall we use AngularJS? Shall we use PHP? Shall we use JSP? Shall we use Spring? And he was like, users, code, booking, security. See the gap of thinking, see the gap of communication. He knows, in real life, we do not talk about functionality, we talk about objects, things. For example, right now I'm feeling terribly humid, What do I say? Give me air, give me air. No, I don't say give me air. I say turn on the fan, turn on the AC. In real life, we talk about objects.
In order to get functionality, we seek objects. We don't seek functionality. So that's what that customer is talking about. He's talking about his things. And I'm a developer. So if I'm only thinking about how do I write a function for this thing, how do I write the local variables, how do I write the global variables, that's not going to work. Our thinking should match. Otherwise, I might end up developing something which is of absolutely no relevance to him. So in that case, what was required was, if he says code, I should be able to write something in my code who is called as code, which represents this code. If he says user, I should be able to write something in my code which represents this user. If he says booking, I should be able to write something in my code which represents this booking. So I should be able to represent the real life objects in my code. I should not only think about functions, local variables, global variables. No. If he says user, I should have user in my code. If he says code, I should have code in my code. And this is called as objects. I'm creating objects in my code. And this way of programming, of trying to simulate the real life things into your code, is called as object oriented programming. Right? So now we understood why this is required. Let's talk about the basics of object oriented programming. So now let's talk about the important aspects of object oriented programming. You could say the major pillars of object oriented programming. First and foremost is object. So what is object? Object is a piece of code which represents a real life thing or real life entity. For example, as I was talking to that tennis complex owner, he repeatedly talked about something called as court, tennis court, right? So if court is a real life thing, every real life thing has two things. One, it has got attributes that we in English call it as characteristics, and second, it has got functionality, which in English can be translated to behavior. So code will have attributes like color, type of surface, maybe dimensions, right? Whereas code will have functionality. Regards to code, what kind of functionality does that shopping or tennis complex provides? Let's say do cold booking, cold cleaning. Now, so in our programming, we map attributes to nothing but variables, or let's say data members, and we map the functionality to functions. So when we write an object in our code representing a real life thing, we write about its variables, what are the data members, which corresponds to attributes, and then we write some functions which correspond to its behavior, right? The next thing is class.
So how we can define class?
Class. I read somewhere in some book, class is a collection of objects, which is so not true. What class really is, it is a specification of the object. Suppose you have been asked to create a student management system for a particular college, right? Now, obviously, the most important object in that system will be student itself. Now, you have identified some things about student, his attributes and his behavior, right? For example, you are planning to store attributes, roll number, name, and marks, whereas you are planning to store the behavior, that is curricular performance and extracurricular performance. So where do you specify this, what you have decided, attributes and behavior? You specify that in class. So you create a class of user. So how do you do that? You write something like this: class student, and then you specify student will have three attributes: roll number, name, and marks, and it will have two functionality: curricular performance and extracurricular performance. So you specify here in the class of student that it will have these attributes and it will have this functionality, right? Now, if somebody increases the marks of student, he increases his marks through hard work or something or copying, his extracurricular curricular performance will change. In another semester, student's marks go down because of his breakup, then his curricular performance goes down. So you see, change in attribute results in change in behavior. If suddenly, for example, if suddenly I put up a lot of weight in, let's say, next 6 months, my behavior will also change a bit, right? So these attributes and behavior are kind of related inside a class. So this is my class. It's a specification of the object. How my student object will look like, what it will have, is specified in the class, right? And then object is an instance of type class. That means, you remember this integer x equal to 5? Do you know this?
Yeah.
What is this integer x equal to 5?
It's a variable which can be equal to 5.
Here, x is a variable of type
int.
Right? So, same way we can say that if you have to create object of student, you will say student s, right? So here we say s is a variable of type student. Student is a class and s is a
object.
So you could say that object is an instance of type class. So class is used to create the specification of object. It's a template or a plan to create object. Once you create a class, write a class, you can create n number of objects of that class. They will all have same type, that is student. Next thing is abstraction. Abstraction really has two viewpoints. So let's talk about first viewpoint, then I'll talk about another viewpoint. So while you're in the process of creation of class, you identified that there is a student object which you need to create because you are creating a student management system. So you need to create student object. In order to create student object, you have to specify the class, what that object will have. Now, I start writing this class student, right? When I write class, I know I need to write two things. First is attributes, the variables, data members. And second thing is behavior, that means functions. But when I talk about student, there are so many attributes possible. Can you give me some examples of student's attribute? Roll number?
Roll number, name.
Name?
Name.
Name.
Age.
Age. Marks. Address. Then we can have hair color. We can have shoe size. We can have
size of student, physical size.
Physical size, weight.
Yeah.
Weight.
Height.
Height. Then we can have
color. Color of face. We can have many attributes. We have to select.
Yeah. Number of boyfriends. Yeah. Eating habits. We can have so many attributes possible for a student in real life. But then we are creating what? Student management system for a particular college. So do we really need to store the hair color of the student? No. Do we really need to store the ex-boyfriend's phone number for a student? No. So we just select some of the attributes out of all possible attributes in real life. We only select few which are required for our application, for our software. In this case, we select roll number, name and marks, and we discard everything else. So this is called as abstraction. This is one viewpoint of abstraction. Taking the necessary details and ignoring the rest. Second is, similar things happen when we try to map the behavior. We can map so many behavior. Psychotic behavior, sports behavior, sportsmanship, discipline, punctuality, communication skills, curricular performance, extracurricular performance. If you make a list, that will be like 1000 behavior of one student. We don't want to write functions for all those in our system, right? So we'll only limit to the things which are relevant to our software. In this case, relevance is curricular performance and
extracurricular performance, which includes everything, right?
So basically, abstractions from developer's point of view is, while you are designing your class, out of all possible real life attributes, you select the attributes which are important to your software, which make relevance to your software, and out of all the possible behaviors, you take a behavior which is relevant to your system, right? So that is abstraction for a developer. Now, this is one view of abstraction. Second view is that when we use APIs, if you must have seen, if you are a Java developer, you use lots of built-in Java functions, right? Or if you are a C programmer, you use the library functions like printf, scanf, correct? Now, you'd straight away call printf without even knowing what that printf is or what's the code of printf. Have you ever seen the code of printf?
No.
No. You don't care, because all you know is, if I use printf, I will be able to print something on the screen. Similarly, in Java, you have like 4,000, 5,000 classes given to you. You just use create objects of those class and use them without even knowing what's the code. So that is also called as abstraction. You don't need to know what you do not need to know. So this is one abstraction when we are designing classes, and that is other abstraction when you are using the ready-made code or ready-made functions from third party. So you don't bother what the implementation of that code is, but you just use it. That is also abstraction. So these are the two viewpoints of abstraction. Now, let's talk about encapsulation. This word encapsulation, does it sound familiar? When I say encapsulation, what do you understand?
Capsule.
Capsule, great. So if I draw a capsule, okay, my capsule is still there. That's pretty much okay. Usually, the capsule looks like something like this. Am I correct?
Yeah, perfect.
So, when we have medicine, if there are tablets available, why do we need capsule? I think both are taken orally. So, why capsules? Sometimes the medicine material, the chemical compound in the medicine, is prone to chemical reaction with the atmospheric ingredients, such as moisture, or sometimes sunlight, or sometimes even oxygen, right? In order to prevent that chemical reaction from happening, because if that chemical reaction happens, that medicinal subject might turn into something else, which might be hazardous to our life. So in order to stop that, so that content is put inside this plastic or whatever the material is, right? And it is enclosed within that capsule, and then it is taken. Now, so that's the very, very basic principle behind encapsulation, is protection. Can you tell me, in object-oriented programming, by doing encapsulation, what are we exactly trying to protect?
Access of data.
Data, awesome. But data is the most important thing in your software application. If there's no data, there's nothing. For example, there is a mobile operator company, information about their customers in their database. So it will include all kinds of people, businessmen, high-class businessmen, CEOs, actors, players, right? So they should have software for management of that customer, right? Everything. So what's the one thing that they cannot afford to do is let somebody hack into their servers and get access of the data. What will happen if you get the phone number of Katrina Kaif, or you get the phone number of Leonardo DiCaprio? Yeah, something will happen, right? So they don't want that to happen. So data needs to be protected. Data is the most essential commodity in your software. So for that we use encapsulation. How? So if you say this student class now, in student class we want to protect this data. We don't want a student marks to be known by everyone, right? So we apply some access specifiers on this. First of all, we put this data and this function within the boundary of a class. Within the boundary of a class. So, the boundary. Right? Now, they are all inside a boundary. They are not free to access to everyone. Right? Second of all, we provide access specifier. So, if we say, these are all private. Right? That means, these variables are only accessible within the class boundary. Nobody can access them outside the class. Right? Now, the important question to ask here is, if I cannot access it from outside the class, what's the use? I mean, where am I using it? I'm just declaring them here, right? How am I going to use them? So then, you have some functions, right? As I said, your curriculum performance depends upon the marks. Marks increase, curriculum performance increases. So curriculum performance uses marks to calculate the output. So even though my marks is a private, the curriculum performance function is making use of those marks. Because these are within the class, right? So it doesn't matter, you can access this. This function can access this. Now there is one simple choice to make. If I make these functions as private too, what happens then is, then my entire class is useless. You cannot access anything out of this class. So what we do is usually, we keep the data private and the functions which have access to the data within the class are made as
public.
So the outside code, the code outside this class can access these functions. And eventually these functions can access data, right? So we are giving access to the data in controlled manner. We are saying, if you want to access this data, call the function. And because the function code is fixed, suppose this function only showcases the marks. It gives you the marks, displays the marks. That means anyone calling this function will be able to read the data, not able to change it. And then there is another function, let's say change marks. This function has the ability to change the marks, right? But inside this function, we might put some authentication code. So when you call this function, it will first ask you username, password. When you give that username, password, then only it will let you change the marks. So see, we are controlling the access to the data. First of all, we are making it private. And we are saying that we have some public functions in the class, which you can call outside the class, from outside the class. And then you can only access our data through these public functions. These public functions are called as interface. Interface is a very, you know, confusing technical term, because there is something language construct interface, which is in C++ and Java. So don't confuse that interface with this interface. Interface here really means that, suppose I have an air conditioner, right, who suddenly stops working. It's not cooling the room anymore. What do I really do is, suppose this is my remote, I say, why is it not working? Right? I start hitting it, you know, open it, maybe change the battery or something. Why am I doing this? I mean, see, in the earlier days when we used to have those TVs with no remote control, whenever there was some problem with TV, we would go to that TV and bang, we'll just do everything possible. Then that is not working, then we'll get the screwdriver, we'll open the TV, get the cathode ray tube, burn it, burst it, and do something unless the TV runs. But nowadays, if your AC is not working, you first play with remote, right? You do everything you can. And then when it doesn't work, you conclude that there is some problem in the AC and you call the customer care. So this is our interface for using that AC. AC is totally covered with that plastic material. They don't want you to touch the AC at all. AC is our data. AC is our data. They don't want it to be accessed by everyone, because we as a non-technical person do not understand what the circuitry of that AC is. So they have given us the public interface, this remote. You access the functionality using public remote. And here the access is controlled. Remote says what you can do, what you cannot do. You can turn on, you can turn off. Increase the temperature, decrease the temperature. That's it. You cannot suddenly say, change the circuitry. No. You cannot suddenly say, destroy the AC. No. It is controlled access that they have given us. And the purpose is to safeguard the system. Here also the same purpose. We are making data private, functions public, because we want to safeguard the data in our software. So encapsulation has two things. First, data and functionalities binded together within a class, binding. And second, controlling the access of the data. What is inheritance? Does it sound familiar to something? Do you understand something when I say inheritance?
Acquired a property from the
parent. Inherited. You have inherited cancer. Have you?
No.
Okay, great. you have inherited lots of wealth from your grandpa or grandma or whatever. So yeah, that is inheritance basically. So you have an object, let's say papa, and then you create another object, say child, and this object uses the properties of parent object. This object is created using the properties of parent object. So this phenomenon is called as inheritance. In simple, right? Now I tell you why this was required. How all the people come up with concept of inheritance. So when you say what was the basic need for object-oriented programming is to simulate the real world into software. We discussed that tennis complex example, right? So real life simulating that into the software world. So in real life there are things. In object-oriented programming there are objects, right? But in real world it's not just about things. It's not just about you and me. It's not just about objects, right? Real world has one more important thing which needs to be simulated. What is that?
Relationship.
Relationship, exactly. That's what I'm saying. In real world, objects work, things work in relationship. Teacher, student, boss, employee, father, child, husband, wife, always there's a relationship involved. Country, citizen. People work, things work in relationship, right? And if we want to simulate the real world in software, we have to simulate objects, yes, but we also have to simulate the relationship. And that relationship is simulated using inheritance. Inheritance is the term which applies for simulation of relationships into software. So this is the relationship between parent and child. So when you create parent class and you inherit a child class receives all the properties of parent class. All the data members, the variables and all the functions. It accounts to reusability of the code. And then, not only that, child can have his own data and his own functionality. So it's not just reusability, but it's reusability with extensibility. You can build upon what has been given to you from your parent. You can take that and you can build upon that. Right? So that's the greatest strength of inheritance. Right? So inheritance is nothing but one object acquires properties of another object through relationship, and then it can also extend that properties. And then we have last polymorphism. Polymorphism is, as you must have heard this in some book, it's a geek term for many forms, right? Polymorphism is used to facilitate the use of the software, to make it easy for end users to use your software. How's that? And this is also regarding the relationship between the objects in real life. Polymorphism really means that one same function when applied on different objects gives you different result. Same function when applied on different objects gives you different results. I'll take an example. Have you played that computer game Age of Empires? So you remember in Age of Empires, you are building your own city. You are building your own city, your streets, your buildings, your citizens, your army, right? So basically, there's one player is playing in this area, while the computer is creating his own world in this area. And then another player here, another player here, right? You create your army, put them at various places, barracks, and archery field and everything like that. Now, after some time, suddenly there's an attack from other players on your city. You remember the sound? Ting! It's so annoying, right? So you can see there's an army at your door from other players. Sometimes they combine, form alliance and attack you, right? When they attack you and your army or your different units are scattered all over the city. So now, what you do is you use your mouse, select all your army at once, and then there are some menu buttons in here, right, on the screen, and there is one button called as attack, right, and you click this attack. Once you click this attack, all of your army Now this army is consisting of different kinds of people. Some of them are archers, some of them are spearmen, some of them are paladins, they are on the horse and doing that and that. And some of them are having gun, very few of them, they are expensive. All these kind of different kind of people who consist of your army. So when you select them all and press attack, they all start attacking this enemy. Right? But they start attacking in their own manner. The archers will stay here at some distance and use their bows and arrows. The spearmen will actually go up to the enemy up front and start fighting using spears. The paladins will reach the first using horses and they will start attacking from the horses. The gunmen will stay the farthest and still they will fire guns at the enemy. But all you did was invoke this action attack on all of them and they responded in different manner. The same command when applied on different objects gave you different results. Right? This phenomenon is called as polymorphism. For user here, if we would not have done polymorphism, then what as a user of this game, what I have to do is I have to go to every archer, attack. Go to my gunman, attack. Spearman, attack. I have to go to everyone, ask them separately to attack. Use your gun, please. Please get your bow. I can't do that. That's not usable. That's really bad. So for ease of use, you implement polymorphism. And that's really, really cool feature of object-oriented programming. By the way, have you noticed something? That in all these different objects on which we applied the attack command, were they kind of related?
Yeah.
Yes, they were related. They were all your army. Although they were their own type. Archers, spearmen, gunmen. But at the end of the day, they all formed one specific class, base type, that is army. So when you go to market and you buy vegetables and you come back home, mother will ask you which vegetables you have bought, or she will ask you which brinjal, tantak, will ask. No, we collectively refer them as vegetables because they are related. She knows that you have gone to market and you have purchased few things, few objects which are related, right? So you can say wash the vegetables. When she says wash the vegetables and I start washing the vegetables, I'll wash them differently. I'll wash spinach differently than how I wash, what you could say, okras, or how I wash potatoes. In potatoes, I will have to wash more to get the dirt off the potatoes, right? So it is implied. She doesn't tell me wash potatoes like that, wash okras like that, wash spinach like that. It's implied because all these okras and potatoes and spinach, they all are related and they are what? Vegetables. And she is saying wash vegetables. But then that wash vegetable command, when applied on individual types, then I give the different implementation. I wash potatoes differently, I wash spinach differently, I wash okras differently. Because that is what is polymorphism is. Right? So for polymorphism to be applied, the individual objects have to be in some kind of relationship. They should all be a part of some common category or common base class. So we'll see more about that when we actually see the coding of polymorphism. So let's get started and we'll see these things in detail syntactically from now onwards. See you in the next session.